If you needed to know how far you've walked, how would you do it? Would you pull out a measuring tape? Would you buy a pedometer? Or let's say you knew precisely the length of each step you took. You could then count your steps. Sometimes robots need to know how far they've gone, and that's where encoders come in.
Assuming your robot has wheels, counting the number of times those wheels turn, or better, fractions of a turn, isn't the easiest thing to do in electronics. This is a rotary encoder. We can shine a light at a disc with holes cut into it, and we can use a light detector on the other side to count the number of times we see that light. And for this example, we know that if we see the light 5 times, we've made 1 revolution.
There are several ways to measure rotations on a disc. That was an example of an optical encoder using visible light. We could have used a laser, infrared light, or even just measured black and white transitions on a disc like this. Alternatively, you could have teeth on a gear that actuate a switch, or you could mash some magnets together and count the number of times you see north and south poles move by a Hall effect sensor. Encoders have all sorts of uses. For example, you might find them on user interfaces when you need a continuously rotating knob. In fact, you probably have an encoder near you right now. If you're using a mouse with a scroll wheel, that scroll wheel likely uses an encoder to determine how far you've moved the wheel. Making a user interface is great, but how can we use this on robots? Because who doesn't want to build the next Mars rover? Well, as it turns out, measuring how far your robot has moved without the aid of some kind of global positioning system can be quite tricky. Let's say that you have a ground-based robot with wheels or treads, like my little robot friend here. I'm gonna call him Fred. And let's say that we need Fred to move exactly 1 meter. Now, your first thought might be, let's measure how far Fred moves when we turn on the motors for 1 second. And then knowing that, we can turn the motors on for a length of time necessary to move that 1 meter. Round.
First, DC motors vary their speed depending on the voltage applied to them. That means as your batteries slowly drain, the motors will begin to spin more slowly over time. So unless you can use a beefy voltage supply or guarantee that your batteries will always be at the same voltage, then spinning the motors for 1 second will result in a different distance every time. Second, most cheap DC motors, like these plastic yellow gear motors, don't run at the same speed, even with the same voltage. That means Fred here will always list lazily to one side.
To fix this, we can use encoders. This is a magnetic encoder disc with 4 north poles and 4 south poles that alternate. And we can either mount it to the output shaft or to the motor's shaft. Note that this gear motor has a 48-to-1 gearbox in it, which means it takes 48 turns of the motor's shaft to turn the output axle 1 revolution. So, by adding the disc to the motor's shaft, we can effectively have more resolution to determine how far our robot has moved. I then tucked the Hall effect sensor under a zip tie to hold it in place and bent it so that the top of the component is as close to the disc as possible. As the encoder disc turns, the detector, a Hall effect sensor in this case, outputs a logic high when it sees a north pole and outputs a logic low when it sees a south pole. The easiest way to measure revolutions is to count one type of edge. For example, if we see a falling edge, that is, the detector's output goes from high to low, then we know the disc has turned 90 degrees. And by that logic, if we see 4 falling edges, we know the disc has made 1 complete revolution. If we wanted even better resolution, we could count both rising and falling edges. Then, each edge we see, we know that the disc has turned 45 degrees and that it takes 8 edges to make up 1 revolution. For this demo, I'm not going to power the motor as I just want to show how to read counts from the encoder. Plug the black wire into ground, the red wire into a power pin, 3 to 5 volts works, and the white wire into an external interrupt pin, which is 2 or 3 on the Uno or red board. I'll use pin 2. In a new sketch, write const int enc pin equals 2, which is the pin our encoder is connected to. Under that, unsigned long ticks equals 0. This is a global variable that stores the number of times we've seen a rising or falling edge on the encoder's output. In setup, write serial.begin 9600, and then pin mode, enc pin, comma, input, underscore pullup. We need a pullup on the Hall effect sensor because it's an open drain output. That means the sensor will only pull the line low, but it won't pull it high. It'll just leave it floating, so we need to pull it up to a voltage. Then write attach interrupt, open parentheses, digital pin to interrupt, open parentheses, enc pin, close parentheses, comma, count ticks, comma, change in all capital letters, close parentheses. Here, we say that the count ticks function should be called every time there is a high to low or low to high transition on our encoder pin. In loop, write serial.println ticks to display the current tick counter. Follow that with a delay 100. Then below loop, write void count ticks, open parentheses, close parentheses, open curly brace, ticks plus plus, and close it with a curly brace. This is the function that gets called each time the external interrupt sees a rising or falling edge on the encoder pin. All it does is increment our tick counter. Upload this to your Arduino. As I spin the motor, the Hall effect sensor detects the magnetic changes on the encoder disk and toggles the voltage on pin 2. Each time the pin changes, our counter is incremented by 1. Remember, every 8 counts is equal to 1 revolution of the motor. So, how do we calculate how far our robot has moved? First, we want to find out how many encoder ticks we need to count per revolution of the wheel. Because of the gearbox, 1 revolution is equal to 48 turns of the DC motor. We also know that the encoder toggles the pin 8 times per motor revolution, so we multiply 48 by 8 to get 384 encoder ticks for each wheel revolution. Assuming the wheel always stays on the ground and doesn't slip, it will move a distance equal to its circumference for each revolution. We can calculate the circumference by multiplying pi by the wheel's diameter, which I measured to be 60 millimeters for Fred. This means that Fred's wheels each travel about 188.5 millimeters for each revolution. With that, we know that if Fred travels in a straight line, then he moves about 188.5 millimeters every time we measure 384 ticks. Divide both sides of the equation by 384, and we see that each tick means that the robot moved about 0.49 millimeters. To get Fred to move 1 meter, which is 1,000 millimeters, we divide 1,000 by 0.49 and see that we need to measure 2,041 ticks before stopping. That solves the distance issue, but how do we solve the problem with Fred pulling to one side? To do that, we'll need 2 encoders, one on each motor. In our code, we can keep track of the number of times each motor has turned, and every few milliseconds, we compare those numbers and see if one motor has turned more than the other. If it has, we decrease power to that motor and increase power to the other. We create a feedback loop to ensure that both motors are moving at about the same rate the whole time. Let's give it a shot. Fred should travel in a straight line for 1 meter, which is right about there. You'll notice that it might be a few centimeters off, and this can be due to potential slipping of the wheels, slipping of the encoders, missing counts in code, or just the sheer momentum of the robot. Better parts and better code can fix this, but for our purposes, being a couple of centimeters off is good enough. If you're curious, the code for making Fred drive in a straight line can be found in the comments. In fact, this is how many of the top competitors at SparkFun's autonomous vehicle competition make their way around the track. The robots move a certain distance, turn, move another certain distance, and so on, which is known as dead reckoning. One thing we haven't talked about is determining the direction the shaft is spinning.
If I spin the encoder wheel halfway around, and then the other direction halfway around, I've effectively made 0 revolutions, but you counted the same number of light transitions as if I've made 1 revolution.
If you were controlling a motor that the encoder is attached to, then you should generally know which direction the shaft is spinning. But what if you wanted to determine the direction that the shaft is spinning because some external force was moving it, like a human? To do that, we could use a quadrature encoder. A quadrature encoder can use the same encoder disk, but it has 2 sensors instead of 1. The trick here is that the second sensor is placed so that when the first sensor goes from a high to low or low to high transition, the second sensor is halfway in one of the zones reading high or low, but not a transition. So when we spin the wheel, detector A follows the same pattern as before, but detector B is 90 degrees off. In this example, whenever we see a falling edge on detector A, we can check what state detector B is in. If B is high on A's falling edge, then we know that the disk is rotating clockwise. Now, rotate the disk counterclockwise and we get a similar pattern, but now it appears that B is leading A. So if we see a falling edge on A and see that B is low, we know that the disc is rotating counterclockwise. I've added two light detectors to my demo to turn it into a quadrature encoder. When I turn the wheel in one direction, the blue light gets brighter on each tick. I can turn it in the other direction to make the light dimmer. I've essentially made the world's worst dimmer switch. If you want to look at it, the code for it can be found in the comments. Just note that you can make it better by looking for both rising and falling edges instead of just one of those. Throughout this video, we've talked about incremental encoders, which work great for measuring distances or counting number of times that an axle has turned. There's another type of encoder that we won't cover here, and that's the absolute encoder. An absolute encoder disc has several different patterns cut or drawn into it. If we place three different sensors along a radius inside this disc, we get a different binary code for each 45-degree arc. We can use this to determine the position of the shaft and not just how much it has moved. Absolute encoders are useful to know what position, say, a robot arm is in, or you can attach it to a weather vane to figure out where the wind is coming from. While you could spend days researching and studying different types of encoders, I hope this has given you a start on building your next interplanetary surface robot or self-driving dune buggy. With that, good luck, fellow explorers. Making a thing. Well, as it turns out, using an optical something or other, or even the measured of. That was an example. Just spit everywhere. And use encoders. This, nope, not that. Oh, there it is. With four north poles and four south pole, I can talk good.